Welcome. My name is Frank Hendricks. I'm recording this video for the ISOS conference in San Diego. And the title of my presentation is The Problem of Insignificant Hands. And this problem concerns all kinds of outcomes, harmful or beneficial, that require contributions from several people. Now, as I am recording this video, there are heavy floods in Europe, in particular Germany, but also the Netherlands and Belgium, Luxembourg, and even Switzerland are being affected. And there are quite a few casualties. Now, we've seen extreme weather events also in the US and in Canada earlier this summer, when there were soaring temperatures that are difficult to cope with for people. People die, actually. Now, these weather events might be due to climate change, and if so, they might be caused by human beings. So even though they appear like natural disasters on the first sight, you can ask, who is to blame? Or could it have been prevented? But also, looking forward, what obligations do we have? Now, for a different example, I moved to Sierra Leone in 2017. It was a big mudslide. It killed almost 15,000 people. Now, this mudslide was also triggered by rainfall, but it was facilitated by deforestation. There were many companies in the area that cut down trees, and that made it much easier for rainfall to turn into a deadly mudslide. Again, we can ask, who is to blame? But also, should people have refrained from cutting down trees? And what kind of obligations do people have in similar situations now? Now, it appears that people think they do have some kind of obligations. For instance, they stop flying. Some people decide not to fly anymore in order to help combat climate change. Or people buy electric cars. And you might have your own example in your personal life. Now, the problem of insignificant hands pertains to examples like this, but also to very different examples. So consider someone who's drowning in a sea, and there's a strong current, and no one can save this person on his own. However, she can be saved by forming a human chain. And again, the question arises, what should we do? Well, what we see around the world is that in some situations, people do form a human chain. And perhaps this is what they should do. Now, let me explain in some more detail what I mean by the problem of insignificant hands. So the problem of insignificant hands pertains to collective outcomes, outcomes that come about only if several individuals act. Furthermore, the collective outcome is morally significant. And here I will focus on harmful outcomes. But the account and the problem generalize to beneficial outcomes, like saving someone from drowning. So the collective outcome is harmful, but the individual contributions are morally insignificant. They are harmless. So if you, as a logger on a mountain in Sierra Leone before 2017, cut down a few trees, that won't really do any harm. It's only when you add up all the efforts for clearing trees, then you see the danger. So as an individual, you're faced with this question, do I have an obligation to do anything? Because you can't make a difference. So why should you do anything? But at the same time, there is this potential harm coming up. Now, the solution that I propose is the prospect account. And the idea is that whether and what you should do depends on the prospect of success. Is there a real chance that you will actually help prevent the harm? And the claim that I defend is that you ought to contribute to preventing the harm if the prospect that you thereby help prevent it is good enough. That, in a nutshell, is the prospect account, and I believe it solves the problem of insignificant hands. Now, this problem has been studied by others, and it's also known as the problem of collective harm or the problem of inefficacy. But I like this term, the problem of insignificant hands, and there's an association with the problem of many hands that makes immediately clear that many people are involved, and it makes this contrast explicit between a morally significant outcome and morally insignificant contributions. Now, what will I do in the remainder of this presentation? Two things. I start by discussing this notion of difference making. So many people, including Walter Sinnott Armstrong, very famously, argue that you don't have an obligation to do anything if you cannot make a difference. Now, I will question this requirement, and I will replace it with a requirement of efficacy. The idea here is that you must be in a position to make a meaningful contribution that has at least some chance to helping prevent the harm. So after I've discussed these issues, I introduce the prospect account. I explain what I mean by good enough. And remember that the core claim was that the prospect of preventing harm has to be good enough in order for you to be obligated to contribute to harm prevention. But what is good enough? Well, it involves the idea of a threshold, and that is a normative threshold because it turns on the moral significance of the outcome. And I will argue also on how burdensome it is for someone who contributes to the solution to engage in that activity. And then I will say a bit more about how the account accommodates this notion of efficacy. And I will relate that to the feasibility of the outcome and the possible redundancy of a contribution. And you don't want to do too much, you don't want to do too little, so you have to take into account these issues. And finally, I will say a bit about normative assumptions. So I will not make any explicit normative assumptions. The account is based on structural features of the situation and how we can think about obligations in relation to those features. So you might expect it to be normatively neutral. However, strikingly, it turns out to be inconsistent with act consequentialism and consistent with basically any other approach. So let me say more about difference making. Now, if making a difference is required, then collective harms rarely obligate anyone, because it's rarely the case that when several people are involved in bringing about a harm, that you make a difference. In fact, if there are more people than needed for bringing it about, then no one makes a difference. Now, if difference making is indeed required, this means that no one is obligated to do anything. And this I call the minimal solution. And it makes quite a bit of sense from the perspective of someone who contributes. Because, yeah, when you make an isolated contributor, let me remind you of the logger cutting down a few trees in Sierra Leone. Yeah, it's harmless what you do. So how can it be impermissible for you to act if you do not cause any harm? And you might ask a follow-up question. If it is impermissible, if it is permissible for me to do so in isolation when nobody else is doing it, how could it be wrong when others do it as well? And Sinnott Armstrong seems to have questions like these in mind when he argues that it's okay to contribute to a harm as long as your individual contribution is not harmful. He argues that if you own a gas guzzler and on a Sunday afternoon you want to drive around just for fun, there's no need to do it. You might think this is bad, this is wrong for climate-related reasons because of the high emissions of the gas guzzler. But he argues there's no good reason to say that. It's not prohibited by any moral principles. And the reason why this is the case, as I read him, is that you don't make a difference. However, let's look at things from another perspective, the perspective of a recipient or a victim, as you might call it. So someone in Freetown, the capital of Sierra Leone, who lost family members, for instance, will say, well, the outcome was very harmful and it should have been prevented. And I don't care how, like if there's, and the causal structure that we philosophers talk about is really irrelevant from the perspective of a victim or a relative. And the question someone like that might ask is, if it's wrong for one agent to affect us in this way, how could it be permissible for several to do so in combination? And to a contributor, a recipient might say, perhaps you are not the problem, you are not the cause of the harmful event, but you're part of it, you're part of the problem. And that's bad enough, and that's reason enough to change your behavior. So difference making seems to be irrelevant for someone at the receiving end. Now, this could trigger you to adopt a maximal solution. So it's always impermissible to perform actions that might contribute to a collective harm. But that is also an extreme solution with its own disadvantages. Because it seems that you will be required to refrain, for instance, from cutting down trees in any situation, irrespective of whether you can thereby prevent any harm, and irrespective of whether enough has been done already by others to prevent harm. And it seems that people do not have obligations that are pointless or futile in these ways. So if the outcome will never materialize, if the harm will never be prevented, then your contribution is pointless. And if the outcome will materialize without your help, it seems that your contribution is futile. So those issues raise the question whether the maximal solution is too extreme in its own way. So we drop the requirement of difference making, but what we get instead is a problem of overgeneration. You're obligated to do something in too many situations. Now, my diagnosis is that the extreme solutions favor one perspective, that of the contributor or that of the recipient. And what is needed is a moderate solution that reconciles these two perspectives. So difference making may be too strong a requirement, but the efficacy of your contribution does matter. And that depends on what other people do. So it seems that a solution to the problem of insignificant hands has to be sensitive to the circumstances in which you are, including what other people are disposed to do, because you don't want your contribution to be pointless or futile. Now, this is where the prospect account comes in. So in the background, we have this claim that difference making is not required. You can be obligated to contribute to harm prevention, even when it's a collective harm where your contribution doesn't make a difference. And strikingly, that it entails that the norm against harm prohibits actions that are as such harmless. And I think that it is actually a very important insight, even though it may sound somewhat paradoxical at first. Now, the core claim of the prospect account is that you are obligated to contribute only if the prospect that you thereby help prevent harm is good enough. And this is this notion of the prospect of success that I mentioned earlier. Now, what does it mean for this prospect to be good enough? And that indicates that there are thresholds involved. And one threshold is causal, so it must be sufficiently likely that the outcome will materialize if you contribute. Because performing an action that is as such harmless is permissible as long as the prospect of harm is low enough. If there's no risk at all that you're cutting down trees is harmful, then sure, go ahead. But if that prospect, the risk of harm, becomes too high, then you ought to refrain from performing your action. And this proposal reconciles the contributor's perspective and the recipient's perspective. A collective outcome that is morally significant can give an agent, an individual agent, a reason to contribute to it. But it need not do so. That is another way of formulating the core message. So there's a collective outcome that is morally significant, and it can give you a reason to contribute to the to a good outcome or to preventing a bad outcome. But it need not do so. It's not an absolute requirement in any independent of any circumstances. And whether it does so depends on the thresholds. The causal threshold is one of them, but there's also an epistemic threshold. There must be enough reason for you to believe that this causal threshold is met. Now, this threshold is based on normative factors, in particular on the moral significance of the outcome, but also on how costly it is for you to refrain from contributing to it. So in the case of the mudslide in Sierra Leone, the number of victims, more than 14,000, that is the core reason why it was so bad, was so terrible. But if you live in the area and your occupation is that of a logger and it's very difficult for you to find another occupation, that weighs in as well. It is also a relevant factor. Now, given how harmful the outcome was, then this factor probably is not very very weighty. But still, it matters, right? You have to sacrifice something too. And think of the gas guzzlers. So extreme weather events that I talked about earlier might be related to greenhouse emissions, greenhouse gas emissions. Now, suppose that you and your fellow gas clusters cause or contribute to some kind of terrible extreme weather event. Then what do you have to sacrifice in order to prevent that? Well, you and the others should not drive around for fun in your gas guzzler. You should find some other thing to do on your Sunday afternoon. Now, whether you should do so, in fact, depends on how other people are disposed, but also on whether you can help convince them. And so the thresholds, whether it's likely enough, is not a static given. Now, as I mentioned, these are normative thresholds, and they are lower when the significance of the outcome is higher, and higher when the costs or the opportunity costs are higher. So what is sufficiently likely, it can be very low. So the probability that you help prevent a big harm can be very low in order for it to be high enough. But then again, it does matter how high the costs are for you. So let me formulate this a bit more precisely. So I'm concerned with an outcome, a collective outcome that has some kind of moral significance, omega, and an action A that carries morally relevant costs, alpha. And these two factors, omega and alpha, determine how high the thresholds are. As you see in the account, there are three thresholds. They are underlined and in its italics. So the prospect account says that you ought to perform this action A exactly if this action increases the probability of the outcome to a sufficient extent. And the probability of the outcome is high enough, taking into account your action. And you have adequate reason to believe that all of this is the case. So three conditions to make precise this idea of the prospect of success and that it has to be high enough. Now, this account does justice to the idea that the efficacy of your contribution in combination with those of others matters. So, for instance, if your contribution is redundant, then condition one will not be satisfied. If there are if 1,000 other loggers, like some companies, have moved out of the area, and you are just a lone logger still living in the mountains, so then if you also stop cutting down trees, that increases the probability of harm prevention, but to a very small extent, and relative to the sacrifice that you have to make, given the total probability of the outcome, that has decreased already dramatically, it doesn't meet this threshold. Now, if preventing the harm is not feasible, and the probability of the outcome will not be high enough. So if you are enjoying your gas-guzzling car and there is no way in which any of you could converge on not doing so, on stopping this practice, then the extreme weather event that is linked to your practice is bound to occur. So you don't really have enough reason to stop engaging in the practice in this case, which is rather unfortunate, but it can be that way. Now, the final question that I asked was, is this account normatively neutral, or is it wedded to a particular normative theory? Now, the thing to note is that this account involves thresholds. And these thresholds are determined by the moral significance of the outcome and the morally relevant costs of the action. And in the end, what you need to do in order to determine whether an action is permissible is compare the actual probability to the threshold probability. And only if that comes out in the right way are you permitted to act. Now, this is very different from a maximizing perspective as used by ACT consequentialists, because there's a range within which your action will be permitted. So the prospect account is in fact inconsistent with ACT consequentialism. But it fits very well with certain forms of Kantianism or contractualism, and perhaps with other approaches. Now, you can read about this on my academia page, but the paper is also forthcoming in philosophical studies. When I submitted it to the conference, I thought it would still be kind of in progress, but strikingly enough, it was accepted in a sense too quickly. But in spite of that, I look forward very much to the discussion and to your feedback, because this is surely a proposal in need of further development. So let me close with a couple of remarks by way of a conclusion. So I've argued that making a difference is not required for having an obligation with respect to some kind of harm or benefit. So the norm against harm prohibits some actions that are as such harmless. And I've proposed a prospect account that says that the prospect of helping to prevent a harm must be good enough in order for you to be obligated. And this proposal is sensitive to the efficacy of the total efforts, your effort in combination with those of others. And more specifically, it is sensitive to the feasibility of the outcome and the redundancy of the contribution. And I think these features make it actually a very attractive proposal that accommodates a wide range of intuitions we have about these cases. So thank you for your attention.